exotic points we're interested in. 10 to the 3, right? Because this is the low cycle fatigue. Low cycle fatigue in here. So we have an equation, we can derive that also. So this right here, let's get that value. That is your fatigue strength factor, F, times your ultimate factor. So I'm going to, as we draw this here, this is just what you need to have. Fatigue strength factor times your ultimate tensile strength. There's, just draw a line right to that. Right. So our fatigue for this one was what, 0.9? 0.9 times 55, that's your, let me see if I did it probably somewhere in here. So I have 40,070, I just don't see where I did the calculation at. Oh, right there. No, that's not. That is not, that's our next bit. I didn't show. So it's 0.9 times 55,000. So I did not, I don't know why I didn't do that calc. Okay, but that's the calculation. We can do it now. Okay. That endurance is at 10 to the 6th, right? So the endurance is at 10 to the 6th, and we would draw this line here to be a little bit different. Thing there. So this is Sn. So we have that. Then it goes straight across. So we want to solve for this here, our fatigue strength, from 10 to the 3rd to 10 to the 6th here. So let's do that right here. So we have the equation for that. So this is N, 10 to the 3rd to 10 to the 6th. Our fatigue strength is our coefficient A times the number of cycles raised to the B power. So we need to find the coefficient A and the power B, and there's your equation, where A is equal to your fatigue strength factor times the ultimate tensile strength raised to the, this is second power, so squared, divided by the endurance. That's A, that's the equation there. B is equal to negative 1/3 the log of our friction factor times our ultimate tensile strength divided by our endurance limit there, Sn, okay? So that has not been corrected, right? So we do a correction on that. So for this one, A was equal to 89,100. B is a negative 0.0851. The equation, this equation then is 89,000 100 times n raised to the power of negative 0.0851. That is this equation right here, a n to b power. So that's the equation we just solved. So if you want to know, hey, at, you know, 20,000 cycles, you know, any value, 25,000, 30, whatever the number is, just plug it in 10 here. Just plug that in and we'll have that fatigue strength. So what we were trying to do, this is the R.R. Morris test. We run it at a certain here, and it breaks. So we hope that it breaks here, 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 right? And we're fitting that curve here, here. So it's breaking here, our loads are getting higher, right? So the loads are higher and higher. Right, we're fitting that. Once we come out here, our loads are, you know, small enough that it goes on forever. This is uncorrected polished. Now let's do some corrections to that. I'm not sure if I did it here or not. I know I did one of them, so we'll look at that one real quick too. So this one you have, you did this one in class, this problem right here, guys, so you should have this in your notes already. But, here it just says, hey, n to the 4, what is the fatigue strength? So it's 10,000 cycles, 10 to the 4. So our fatigue strength, 40,000, 70. So it says, what is the safety factor? Well, that's the fatigue strength of the material, because this is based on the material. So we're testing the material. That's the strength of the material in fatigue, right? So if we statically load something, we know we have a yield strength, we have the ultimate strength here. We have our endurance strength of the material, but it's a material property. So that 40,000, that's the number 40,700. The 35,000 was given. They say, okay, we loaded this part and our alternating stress amplitude is 35,000. So, what does this look like, the stress amplitude? Here's N, here's our stress. This is 0, here's our stress amplitude. It gave us at 35,000. The mean stress is 0, right? Mean stress is 0. We are just bending it, right? We'll talk about when mean stress, I'll make sure you understand that too. This is a reversed and repeated loading. Reversed and repeated loading. 0, mean stress, amplitude stress. So our safety factor then is the stress that we calculate. So whatever power that stress was calculating, say our stress, say bending, say we had some bending stress, MC over I, that's our alternating stress. Okay, so we had a safety factor of 1.6. So what is the number of cycles to failure for that 35,000? So here, let's just look at this so we kind of see said at 10 to the fourth, we calculated this, 40,700. But we only have 35,000. So there's our safety, not a lot of safety factor. You can just see that we calculated 1.6, right? So this value is 35, we can go up to 40,700. So that exceeding is at 1.16, right? So now it's asking, if we take it all the way to our limit, how many cycles can we take it to? So now we're gonna take this, we'll use that as our SF. We have A and B and solve for N. It should be around in here. Okay, so that's what we do there. We'll plug it in there, we get an N of 58,697. Again, I think we've solved this. You should be in your notes there. But I'm just going over it again. What I did here is, so for low cycle fatigue, there's the equation. So for low cycle fatigue, this equation is, so our ultimate tensile strength times our number of cycles, N, log of F, raised to the log of our fatigue strength factor divided by 3. Let's make sure that is log of F divided by 3. That's the power. So what I did, just to verify, I plugged in 10 to the 3 thing was 49,500, and this is good here to here, 0 to 1, so it's good from 1 to 10 to the 3, and I plug that in, and it works out properly to here at 49,500, which is also the fatigue strength factor times our ultimate, so I know we're good with the equation. At least a check, and then at 100 cycles, what is our fatigue strength of the material? 51,000 and some change there. Everybody see that? So there's two equations. This equation there is good for this, right? This equation here is good for this from 10 to the third cycles. 10 about a million, and then our low cycle fatigue is from 1 to 1,000 cycles. That's the equation. Okay, so you may have a problem like that, is what I was thinking. One problem going through that, and that's half the problem, right? Sorry, we see two more. So, so we'll come back to those there, but let's just get to one page that I want. So here's the fatigue strength factor, so you have a copy of that. So watch this equation in the book. So I'm going to change all of that. I mean, they did it a different way, and I never understood what they were trying to do there. So maybe this needs to be corrected a bit better. Okay, so this is what I'm talking about. So this is uncorrected. Are estimating actual endurance strength, or you know, it's also known as just corrected endurance limit, would be down here. It's going to be less Sn prime. That's equal to Sn, this value right here, right? Half the ultimate times our size. Material, type of loading, and I got a Y. I can't say that. I have to jump together a little bit. Reliability and size. This is polished. Okay. This may not be polished, right? Because we're correcting it. So that's polished. This may not be. So this may not be that. I apologize for that. That may not be that. Because we do have to, do this right here. Here's polished. And we had, 55? So right in here, after that, 27,000. 60 to 55 right there, 27,000. Okay, so if we say, hey, it's machine, ground machine or whatever, it's going to be a less value, right? So again, our ultimate here, so we may want to take, say even machined about right there, say maybe, so that's 30, 25, so maybe 21,000, 22,000. So let's say for machine, we would use Sn equal to 22,000, 22,000, not the polished, which was 27,500, whatever it was, right? So does everybody see the difference there? So this is uncorrected, we have everything good. Now we need to go through this. So the material, we'll be using one there. The type of loading for, let's just look at it. It's gonna be right there, right here. So the type of material, we'll only do steel on the test, so that'll be one. So you could have bending, which is just one. And it's just one because it's based on RR Morris. The bending stress is only, remember, bending stress is max here. Bending is max there, MC over I. Zero here. Bending is zero at the neutral axis. Bending stress is zero there. Axial stress is constant throughout, so it's going to be higher. So we use 0.8 there as a factor. Reliability, we'll get from this here. So you've got to be given the desired reliability. Get your reliability factor. And then the size factor. Okay, so there's the size factor, which we have this diameter, and we take that off. And we have the equations. So these three equations from diameter 0.3, 0.3 to 2, 2 to 10, represent up to 0.3, 3 to 10, or sorry, did I say that right? 0.3 to 2, 0.3 to 2, that's represented there, and then the rest of this curve is represented by this equation. be, what we would have is this. And this SF is equal to A and B, kind of the same thing we did up here, but different A and different B, right? Different A and different B. There's your A here. So that's for uncorrected. There's your B. The only thing that changes, look at this, this endurance, instead of this, you use this value right here. So this goes to SN prime there. So this is uncorrected. Uncorrected. And what that means is we have a perfect specimen. We ran the RR Moore test machine. We machined that specimen. You know what that little radius there? Perfect radius, very nice finish. It's the perfect condition. So we have that. It's the best scenario you can have. Now comes reality. You have the shaft, it's been machined, it got nicked, it got banged. And you know, hey, what kind of reliability you have, this diameter, maybe we have some factors in there that put, if you take into account. So this would be lower. And you use this equation here. So this is the uncorrected. So corrected would be A is equal to your fatigue strength factor times your ultimate tensile strength squared over SN prime. B is equal to negative 1/3 log of F times your ultimate tensile strength over your corrected. So this is your corrected right here, SN prime. So now we have this equation based on the new A and the new B. So we say, well, okay, who does this? What are we doing in class? What do you do in industry? You take SN prime. Because that gets you life, right? That takes out, hey, from here to here, if you say, hey, we want to size this prime. Precisely, we want to go and know what our life is, like the last thing we were talking about, from here to here, that's what you do. But you, if you're going to want to say, okay, we're under fatigue, I don't want this thing to fail, that's the endurance strength I'm going to use. That's the endurance strength I'm going to use. You're done. Let's talk a little bit about Goodman's criteria. And so you can have, you know, you'll have to know how to plot this out. I'll ask you that. And this is an example. The only thing that's going to drive everything is this here and that F, right? So look that up in the material. Get your ultimate tensile strength and go through and solve that. So that covers that. The next thing you really want to know is this Goodman's equation. So in, when do we use Goodman's? So I'm going to go back and just talk a little bit. Let's go way back here and we'll go through this. Just a little bit. Static loading, right? You load it once. That's right here. That's the scenario we have. So what we've done right here is this right here, which is this right here. Repeated and reverse stress. Your alternating stress or stress amplitude, mean stress is zero, right? Because it goes from, you know, a positive stress to a negative, equal magnitude back and forth. And again, shaft loading and bending is a great example of that. don't have that scenario, zero mean. You can have these scenarios. So instead of reversed and repeated, they call these fluctuating stresses or pulsating stress. Zero mean, right? So it could be, you know, zero mean, we know, it could be anywhere positive mean to a negative mean. It could be a positive mean with, you know, you're pulling on it with 1,000 pounds to then you reduce the force to 500, but it would always be positive. Or you can pull on 1,000 pounds and then compress it, say 200 pounds. That would be, say, this scenario, just as an example. You can have negative means, so just being full compression. So, you know, you compress it 1,000 pounds to 500 pounds compression. So those are your things. So this is fluctuating. If you don't have this, you have fluctuating. If you have fluctuating, you have Goodman's. Why? Because we have a mean stress and we have an alternating stress. Here, reversed and repeated, alternating stress, zero. Let's look at Goodman's, and then Goodman's will show us how to solve for reversed and repeated and what we do here. So, so I guess another kind of special case is where your max and then your min is zero there. Right. So that's okay. But still fluctuating stress on this. Like you have an alternating stress and you have a mean stress. So we solve problems, so we know how to solve for our, let's erase some of this stuff here. I think it gives us a little more room. So we have our mean stress is the max plus min divided by 2. So our mean stress is your max stress plus minimum stress divided by 2. Your alternating stress, what is your max minus your minimum stress divided by 2. Okay? You can solve for the stress ratio. We just did R. We were just using that R, and that gives you these scenarios, you know, depending on where the R is. Hey, it's this. But again, you can see, you know, you can, once you have the values, you know what it is. Okay? So, let's not go through that example that we did. This is an example we did. So distortion energy theory. So these are our static loading theories. Maximum shear stress theory, which is this equation. So that's just statically loaded. So you don't use endurance strength. You have a yield strength. So this is the equation you use. You can use the other theory, distortion energy theory. So these are covered in 215. Again, it was a little messy last year, so or last semester, so hard to know. Von Mises stress, which is here is your Von Mises stress, and then here you put in energy yield. So no endurance strength. We're not using endurance for this. We're using yield if you have static loading. This is all the things you do for that. Let's now stay on fatigue. That's what we're studying here. And again, low cycle up to 10 to 3,000, high cycle. Your, say your infinite life is, so they're taking it a little bit past, but we'll say 10 to the 6, okay? This is different books, a little bit different stuff. Here's our fatigue book. So we would use the Goodman's criterion. So that's the yield line. Let's go to Goodman's criteria right here. So our Goodman criterion is stress concentration times our alternating stress over the endurance strength. So there's your endurance strength, your mean stress over your ultimate strength, ultimate tensile strength, equal to 1/60 factor. So our Goodman criterion, look at that. Safety factor is equal to our stress concentration times the alternating stress over our endurance. This is our adjusted endurance strength there, our corrected endurance strength, plus the mean over the ultimate tensile strength. Use for fluctuating stress, right? Fluctuating stress. So if you have fluctuating stress, use the Goodman's. Because you've calculated the mean, calculated the alternating stress. Yeah, we'll talk about the stress concentration a little bit. We know how to do the endurance strength. Our corrected or estimated actual endurance strength, that's what it's called in the book. But it's the corrected endurance strength, right? We know how to do that. The ultimate strength is just the material, the ultimate strength of the material. Just plug in, we need to look at that a little bit. We'll look at that. If you have this scenario for reversed and repeated, mean stress equals 0. Let's write it in terms of our safety factors. Don't forget that's our safety factor, not the number of cycles. So I don't want to be confusing there. Just watch that, okay? Safety factor. So our safety factor N, is equal to our endurance, our adjusted endurance strength times our stress concentration times our alternating stress. Where does the alternating stress come from? It comes from your MC over I, that's bending stress. It could be axial, let me spell that out, it's a force over area. So we calculate this to say for a normal problem, but we know it goes positive to negative, positive to negative, positive to negative. So we're bending something, bending it this way, the same amount, reversed and repeated. If you have two different values, two different m's, say, and bending moment is 5,000, bending moment is 10,000, you solve both of these are positive. Mean stress and an alternating stress. This is the alternating stress. Mean stress goes to 0. For reversion, And this is really just this right here. You're all setting this stuff. So you can still calculate it like you normally do. Because you have your alternating stress is right here, your stress amplitude or alternating stress. Max this minus this, which is negative. So minus a minus. So say that is 10,000 psi. 10,000 minus the negative, you know, in your compression stress is negative 10,000. So minus the negative 10,000. Which is positive 10,000. 10,000 plus 10,000 is 20, divided by 2 is 10,000. It's just this. Let's talk about stress concentrations, because that's the other thing we got to do. Many of these have some stress concentrations. And if there's not, then you know, you can use a 1 there. But otherwise, we would use a stress concentration factor. So we got here. So, stress concentration factor. So this one's also good when it's fluctuating stress. Here's where we're gonna get that stress concentration factor. So in the back of the book, it has all the different types of stress concentration factors. So you got to go through that. Let me show you one on that just to remind you how to do that. So it's here. It's something that would be. So here's some stress concentration. Let me see if I can get this up a little bit here. So here's an example. So if you had axial stress right here, I'll give you two examples just so you can see a couple. So axial stress, and we have a step down shaft, which has this radius here, right? That's a stress concentration. The smaller that radius, the larger the stress concentration factor. Here's our stress concentration factor, which, really means, see this value right here? Stress concentration times the nominal value gives you the max. This is the max. This is what they call in there would be the nominal. That's like just the nominal, which is just this. So we could just, you don't have to so much even worry about that, but you do have to get the stress concentration factor. So you just look at what they're asking for. Radius over the small diameter gives you a number. Use that number, say it's 0.16. And then the large diameter divided by the little diameter gives you a number. So you would take that to, say if it's 1.5, it's gotta be in between there somewhere. So I would just come up to here and then over, and there's my stress concentration factor. Okay, so that's an example. What other example would be? So there's bending. So the same thing with like bending. So if you have MC over I with a step shaft. So if you had this, you would be using this equation. Same thing with radius divided by diameter. Diameter over D gives us this, and then now you go whatever this value is, take it up to your diameter over D, and you know, just get close to one of these and kind of follow up and then do your stress concentration. So multiply that by your alternating or stress amplitude, which would be this. Obviously this, you know, with the Goodman's here, right, we're going to use this. Questions? All right, so that's chapter 5. For homework, what did you, what ones did I give you for homework here?
We did 48 in class.
48 in class. Do we do any other ones in class?
It was 10, 48, 72
in class. Did I do the 72 one in class?
Yeah.
Okay, so you have that.
I have one
and
two.
Yeah, so that's pretty good. All right, so I need to get you, if we want to do a problem then. Well, I don't want to do a problem right now. What I want to do is, did you have a question on 67?
Yeah,
so let me answer the questions on 67. Make sure that's at least addressed. And then we'll go from there. Let you guys decide. point B, two areas of stress concentration, right? You want me just to talk about this one? You want a homework problem? A different problem for the takeoff?
Yeah, honestly.
No problem. Stress concentration, we're loaded there, simply supported, stepped, but it's not a shaft, it's a flat, right? I don't know where the thickness is. So when you go to solve this problem, all these problems, just how you normally set up a statics problem. Get your free body diagram, reactions, note that your force here is reversed and repeated. So this one's reversed and repeated. I will just take one of these. I'm not going to worry about it's going down, it's going up, it's going down, going up. Okay, I know it goes up. I'm just going to analyze going down. Because it's the same as I put it this way, it goes up. So I'll just pick one direction. Get your reactions. So I have this. The first thing I have to do is solve for reaction. Reactions now. Once I know my reactions, so I solve for my reactions at A, RA 150, and then RE is 250. So don't forget how you do a shear diagram. That's the next step. RA 150 over to the point load down. So what was it down? 400 over 250 up. RE is 250 up. Closes it up. That's your next step. Free body diagram, solve for reactions, get your shear diagram, bending moment diagram is next. Solve for my areas under the shear diagram. So area A1, 150 times the length of this here. So 0.25 meters. Times our newtons here gives us 37.5 newton meters. I have my bending moment here. So when I'm doing this problem, it's doing three problems, right? It's doing three analyses at B, C, and B. So we're not just looking at point B and move with it, point C and go, but you have to solve for B, C, and D. So you have to do it like three times. So you gotta get your bending stress at B, C, and D. We know this is 37.5, so I can solve for B. Right, similar triangles. So 37.5 is to MB. So I take 37 over 250 is equal to MB over this 150 here. And then solve for MB. And then do the same thing for MD. I would use this right triangle. Just similar triangles, right? This triangle. Inside of that triangle. Here's that shell. Okay. and B, the moment of B, FD, is equal to 100 millimeters, and that's equal to the moment of C over 150. And it's all three. Now here's B too, same thing. MB over 150, MC over 250, sorry, this one, whatever. Okay, got that? Now we know bending moment at B, bending moment at D, and bending moment at C. We just don't say, I know the bending moment at C is the maximum bending moment, but I have different I values and stress concentrations. So I don't know where is the stress critical on this thing. Is it at B, C, or D? So here's our material. SAE 1340. Oil quenched and tempered, 1350. So again, you'll have all this, because this is a nice little example to do this, integrate this in, right? All of this. So this is what we're doing now. Now we have the material. We have reversed and repeated problem here, right? Reversed and repeated. So for this SAE 1340, there's our ultimate, there's our yield. We can solve for our fatigue strength, or not solve, but we'll use that chart. Use our ultimate, that gives us 0.845. Our endurance strength is half the ultimate. Now let's solve for our coefficient A. Our power B, right, just plug in. These are non-adjusted. So there is that equation, right? At 1,000, I verified this. Maybe 84,500. Let me go back. So I'm going to stop there for a second. When I was doing this, I did it right here. This problem's metric, right? It's metric. I had there. This is, you know, I integrated this in. Okay, I forgot, it's metric. So I did all this in English, and then I said, okay, I need to do it in metric. There's metric. It's the same thing. So when you see that, just realize I was sitting there, my brain went to English units, and I had to do it twice. So here's ultimate tensile yield, things that can get your fatigue strength, your endurance strength, divided by two, your coefficient A, B, and there's our equation. So here's this plotted here. Now let's plot this one. So the one I just did was this one right here. Here's this. A was 985.3. There's B, 0.076. That's the equation. So let's get this value here. So this value is, so look at this right here, your ultimate. We machine, here's your new endurance strength. So remember this one, where does this one come from? It's 55.11. It's machine, and there's our ultimate. Right? So 690. We went to 250. There's the metric one right here. It says 690. Went to 250. 690. Your ultimate tensile. 690 is 700. Here's machine. So 690 is a little bit this way. So about right there. Almost. So maybe just a little bit above 250. SPSN. So this is our ultimate, and this is our SN. SN different than the ultimate divided by 2. Ultimate divided by 2, 690. Ultimate divided by 2 is about 350, right? Half. But that's polished. That's polished. That's perfect condition. You will always have, you know, it adjusted. And you see that? Let's go back to the problem at hand here. And we go back up. See, this is polished. 690 ultimate tensile strength divided by 2 is 345. That's polished. This is 250 times the 4 correction factors. Takes it down to 220. All right, 250. Here's our 4 correction factors. I'm not going to go through those. Just time and do that. And there's your. I did not solve for this here. I could have solved for that. As I said, this is we do it the same way. The only difference is you replace this SN with SN prime, 220. Instead of 345, 220. 220. Okay. Then you can solve for this one here. I should have done it. Don't know why I didn't. Okay, I didn't because. It would be nice, I would like to do it because hey, you should know more, yes, I understand. But we use this. You know, we don't have to do all that. We just need to use this right here. That's what we're going to use in this equation or this one. This we have reversed and repeated conditions, so we're using this. This is for fluctuating stress. When you have a mean and you have an amplitude stress, this is when we have this, our mean stress is zero. Okay, so let's move on. So look at B, MC over I, the bending moment. So that bending moment, a lot of times I'll write a bending moment MB, but that's bending moment at B. And times C over I. So again, this is a flat plate. I is 1/12 BH cubed here. So that is our bending stress. Our max bending stress is that. Minimum bending stress is negative. Mean is zero. That's our stress amplitude. Now you have all that. Here's your stress concentration. So go look up a flat plate that's bending. A flat plate that's bending. Here we're looking for a flat plate that is bending. Right here. So you use this. Radius over this height, and then a large height over the small height, you do that curve. Very much the same curve though. Okay. So there's R over H. H over H gives us a stress concentration. Here's our safety factor. We have the reversed and repeated problem, guys. So we have, first we're using this equation. Take your stress concentration factor. Stress concentration 1.6. Your alternating stress, which is the bending stress, and there's your adjusted endurance strength. But you see where that's coming from? It is a lot of information, but if you get it, it just makes sense, hopefully. Because you're doing a couple things. where, you know, we're dealing with different types of stress, then our stress, you know, for the Goodman is flexion stress, and now we have this one. So there's no mean. We did a problem with mean. We want to go through that one too, because we might end up using the Goodman's. I mean, well, I think we might do a take home. I think that's the best thing. These problems are difficult. We want a little time to work on it and not be pushed to the limit then.
Can we still email you if we don't understand something about a question?
Yeah, you can definitely email me. I would, if you email me something, I would answer you what I think I need to. You know what I mean? Hey, I can't answer that. Totally, you know, like you said, hey, can you just give me the final answer? I say, hey, did a nice try, but I can't give you the final. And I would, and then, but if you have the question, hey, I don't understand this, if I email you, I'll kind of copy that question and send it to everyone. Say, hey, someone asked this. This is as much as I can give you. All right, so I'll let you do the rest for that. So here's that C. So C didn't have any stress concentration. See the stress concentration one there? Because that's where the loading was at. There was no stress concentration. And D, there was the hole. So you gotta find that in the appendix, and then that'll give you this here. So this is the equation they give you to solve for a hole and bending. So let me just look real quick here. So there's your, see where it says bending stress right there? That's the equation I use. Calculate your D divided by W. D is the what diameter of the hole. And W is the width here. So, right here. W and D. So and then plot that to here over the D stress concentration. So we got 67 done. John, did that help you?
Yeah.
And I'll send you this too. I'll send you this, my solved solution. So you'll have that to help. Okay. So we have some homework problems that you did. You did some problems in classes. So that's chapter 5. All right. So I'm going to send you a problem to do out of there. I'll look at problems and see what looks good.
The 69 is pretty much the same thing, except we're doing with that radius and stuff.
Did I give you 69 to do?
Yeah.
Yeah. 69 is goodness, right? Because we have a fluctuating normal stress. So normal means perpendicular to the cross section. So we just have bending stress. But we don't have reversed and repeated scenario here. Right? So the last problem was reversed and repeated. This is not. So I calculate the minimum bending stress and the max bending stress. That gives me the mean and the max. The mean and the alternate. I don't have to do all this work. I don't have to do any of that. The reason why is I just need to do this. All I have to say is I have to do this if I want the life to be between here and here. As soon as you say, I don't want to worry about it, make it not break, you use this. So in industry, not too many people are doing that. Right? But you know, I'm trying to educate of why, what this curve is, how it's developed in that. But you'll see everyone jump to that. So here, I'm not in this problem, I'm not solving all that. The last problem I did, just to show you again, we didn't need to. You say, okay, well, what did we use that? No, we use this. Okay. So I just want to say that, just so you're not confused. So here's the SN value, and Goodman's. Goodman's stress concentration factor. Alternating stress over that your estimated actual endurance strength. Use what we call our mean stress over the ultimate stress strength. Whatever. In the other two problems, you know, I think they said, hey, make it a radius bigger. How does that help you? So we improve that. Maybe 71 said, hey, use a better material. How does that help you? So, again, I'll send this again. All right, chapter 5, how is that looking? So these are hard problems just to say, hey, do your homework, right? I mean, that's so hard for me. I mean, I love sitting down with a cup of coffee and writing out 11 pages. You know, it's a couple hours, you know. But if you know what you're doing, you're just going through it and you can enjoy it. If you're totally, what is going on? And it's very easy to be, hey, what is going on? So, you know, understand what difficulties are. So you can see, I mean, I'm, you know, how long my problems are. Right? So this problem right here, the 7 pages. I try to make it even. Questions for 5? So I gotta find a problem. What you can do there. So it might be 2 problems. It might be just like problem 67. And don't worry about any of this. So I'm gonna send you problems 67 and 69. So it might be like 69, just use Goodman's. And then a second problem, hey, with this material, plot our SN diagram and just do that. Might be something like that. If it's like 67, then I can kind of combine it because it's reversed and repeated. Right? Reversed and repeated. 67 was. 69 was not. 69 was fatigue. All right, let's stop there with that and let's just talk about the. Shaft problem. So the shaft problem I'm going to give you for take home. I already had that one selected. So let me look at it again and make sure. It's a little bit of work. We did one problem in class, so not a lot. Actually, there's an example too in class, in the book. So it is, we don't want anything with thrust loading. Yeah. So, So are we in agreement with a take home test, just so I know what we're doing?
Yeah,
anyone wants
good.
A take home? Anyone not want a take home? Just in case I get everybody okay with a take home.
I need to get the
all right. So I'm gonna get you a problem from chapter 5. From chapter 6 though, your take home problem is 12, 3, 15, 16, and 24. It's one problem, but it is 15, 16, and 24. Okay, this is a chap problem, so there's one problem, chap problem. So in doing these, make sure you do it neatly, because there will be multiple pages here. You're not going to get around that. So don't, if you really do it, stuff all over the place, like this, where you just can't follow, then your grade will reflect that. So make sure it follows. So if you want to know what it needs to follow, I'm going to give you the steps here. And what I could do, what I'll do to you guys, I will send you for this problem, maybe the steps. If you want to do, hey, solve this, then do this. I could do that and kind of guide you through that. If you think that would be helpful.
Kind of like the lab that we got.
What's that?
Kind of like the lab, like this.
Yes, yeah. Do something like that. So as a matter of fact, that's exactly it. So. I know we've covered this, but I'm going to go through this one again because I think it's just, you know, we'll just review a few things and some of the steps. And even the steps we can kind of lay out for you even here, and then you'll have all your steps, you'll know what to do. So so we're analyzing this shaft here. This shaft and the other one, both you have to analyze two planes. This front plane and the top plane, say. Okay. The thing you want to look do is you want to, like the first step here is go through, if they give you power, calculate your torque through the system. And I think they would give you. Yes, 5 horsepower to the chopper, there's 3 horsepower to the blower, there's 3 horsepower there. So let's talk about that a little bit, because I don't want to just leave that go. Whoa, that's way harder. So it would have been fine if I would have did this problem in class and the other one. Let's read the problem. I want to talk about this problem too, because I just don't want you to go out of this one. Let me read this one. Problem 3. suburbia B, 2014 diametral pitch of 8. So we can solve for the pitch diameter there, 24 divided by 8 for pitch diameter. The horsepower for canyon drives, so 5 horsepower to. I'm going to show you this. I can't just say go. So I'm going to just bring up that problem and let's see if we can get you going a little bit on that one. So here's. Let's go through the problem. So this will be our take home, but let's kind of get you started and get you in that. Okay, so it's a difficult problem. I have an easier problem too that I can give you. This one's very complicated, guys. I mean, you know. There's just power coming in is equal to power coming out. So I know my power in, I know the speed of the shaft, I know the torque right here, but then that torque is split. Some of that power is coming here. Power is using here and here. 3 horsepower, 3. And this one is just, I think, way too much. So let's just look at it. I think, you know, so I can solve. I know the speed of everything. So horsepower divides gives me a torque at B, torque at E, torque at D, and I can. Let me just show you this. I don't think we're gonna do it. I just think it's way too hard. I'll find something more reasonable. But let me just. So we talk about torques a little bit and horsepower. Remember, again, this is just to learn here, this right here, power, torque, times speed. I know that shaft turns at 480 RPM. That means I know a couple things. Power in is equal to power out. So my power coming in through here feeds this and these two. My torque in, right there is the total horsepower. Torque in, which is torque at that C, is power in over speed of that shaft, which was 480 RPM. It's gonna, I'll show that. So I know my torque is this value here, coming in. Part of it goes this way, part of it's used by these two. These two have the same torque, it's the same horsepower. So 393 plus 393, right? Because this has to turn both of these torques, so it's the sum of those torques. So that's your torque distribution, just alone. Yeah, this, you're not going to have this problem. Forces on gear B. I'm just going to kind of throw, so that gives me your forces on gear B, the forces of the valve there, where you have all these forces. The fourth chain spur, that's our input. Solving for the vertical plane, solving for your axis, taking moments, summing forces in the Y. This is all the forces and reactions. Then you're getting this shear diagram, getting this bending moment diagram, and going through every sizing the shaft at B's, at A, B, C, D, E, F. So, to page 8, page 9, getting the horizontal ones, getting all, summing all the moments, and then solving for the diameters from page 10A, because I must have had 10, so it's really 11, going through each one, getting the material, getting the safety factor for all that, there's all your forces. So, I looked at it. I didn't look at it. I just said, oh, that's okay. If they want to take home, that'll be all right. And he ended up looking at it. If I'd have looked at it earlier this morning, I would have said, no way. I'll find something. Now, if you do any shaft design in industry, you will come across this stuff, guys. So I do a lot of machinery, so these have shaft designs all the time. So I do a lot. How do you feel with the, not this problem, but just in general, the shaft? Are you okay with the 12, the one, you only have one example. I really feel like you need it for 7. Like I needed to solve this in class, but I need another, it's a full day to solve it, 2 hours. This one solve one problem.
What's that? Is this one
that you can send
us?
Yeah, this is something I can send you to, so you can have. So you have 12.
Really involved, but it'd be a nice one to deal with.
Yeah, so again, you know, if you, depending on what you do in industry, this might be, say, I'll keep this as one of my example problems. I'll send you. So what across I'm supposed to send you 12.3, this one here, 12.3, 15.16, and then 67 and 69?
Yep.
Okay. So if you do not see this in a day or two, you have to email. Say, hey, where's our example problems? Just so you get it. Okay. All right, let's do that. And I would like to go through that one. It's actually a nice one to do. I just go, you know, an hour and a half into it to start it, enough talking.